Hello, I'm Dave Hart. I'm the preacher for the Winslow, Arizona Church of Christ, and I'm so glad that you've chosen to join me today. We're going through a series of lessons looking at the seven churches in Revelation, and we're to the third church today. And once again, as we go through and we take a look at this church and the seven churches, we see that each of these churches had difficult things they were going through. They were dealing with problems, they were dealing with difficulties. They were all having one or another issue. Many of the issues were different, some were the same. And I would like to believe that everyone listening today, as well as me, we want to make our church, wherever we serve at, to be the best church it can possibly be. Don't you want that? I know I want that for the church here in Winslow. My hope is to have a church with no problems, and we just always run at full speed. Everybody gets along, and we just, you know, are about doing the Lord's work. But I believe that one of the great lessons of the seven churches in Revelation is it teaches that that is not always the reality. In fact, probably more times than not, it is not the reality. There's going to be issues, there's going to be problems. And if you do have a time when things are going fairly well, when it doesn't seem like there's any kind of major problems, major issues, unfortunately, at some point down the road, there will be some problems, some major problems or issues that we don't foresee at this particular time. But I believe that the seven churches in Revelation teaches us that when there are problems, we need to fix them, because that's what Jesus is telling them. He's telling them they need to get these churches fixed. They need to take care of these problems. Even though it might not be an easy fix, it might be a fix that takes time. Sometimes that fixes the problems itself is time. Maybe you have a couple in the church that just cause a lot of problems with each other or with the church, and sometimes it may just be a matter of one of them or another moving away or something to that effect. But we do have to realize that problems are a natural part of the church. Always has been. We can read all through the epistles that Paul wrote and others, and almost all of them have to do, a great amount of them have to do with fixing things, with fixing problems, fixing issues. So don't think your church is strange because it's going through these things. Don't think that the grass is necessarily greener on the other side of the fence. Just realize that God desires for us to fix problems and make the church where we are serving at to be the best church that we possibly can. Be the best church that it possibly can. And there again, sometimes you go through some real dark times and it just takes time, and we have to trust in God and get through some things. But we do have to be proactive at the same time. We got to realize there are problems and do what we need to do to fix them. So today we're going to be looking at the church at Pergamos, the church at Pergamos. And they are known as the compromising church, as the compromising church. This is something we must never get caught up with, is compromise. Far too many churches are compromising churches today and compromising Christians. And we are to never, ever do that. Once you start compromising, it never ends. It just keeps going and just keeps going and just keeps going. So we do not want to be the compromising church. And we're going to see here some of the ways the church at Pergamos was compromising. But also we're going to see some things that they were still doing right. They were still doing right. So if they keep compromising, of course, there'd be less and less they're doing right. People are going to see this church was doing some things right, but they were also doing some things that were very wrong. So let's look at Revelation 2, 12 through 17. Revelation 2, 12 through 17. And to the angel of the church in Pergamos write, these things says he who has the sharp two-edged sword. I know your works, and you dwell where Satan's throne is, and you hold fast to my name, and you do not deny my faith, even in the days in which Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was killed among you where Satan dwells. But I have a few things against you, because you have there those who hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to put a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed to idols and commit sexual immorality. Thus you also have those who hold to the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which things I hate. Repent, or else I will come to you quickly and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give of the hidden manna to eat, and I will give him a white stone, and on the stone a new name written, which no one knows except him who receives it. So, as I said, there were some things that the church was doing that was good, and there were some things that the church was doing here at Pergamos that was very, very wrong. So let's kind of break some of this down and go through this and see some of the things they were doing good, some of the things they were not doing good, and some of the things that we need to do the same as they were doing, but also see some things that we need to be careful of, so that we don't do some of the things that they were doing. So it says that they dwelt where Satan's throne was. So they were surrounded by an evil surroundings around them. They have all kinds of ungodliness going on, false teaching, false doctrine, immorality, all this kind of stuff. They were in the midst of that. It's kind of like the church today. We are in the midst of that in America, aren't we? We see all the perversion going on, the homosexualizing of America. I still can't believe the kids' shows. The kids' shows that has so much homosexuality in it. I was watching a show that I've been following for several seasons called Camp Cretaceous, and it's kind of a animation show that's a takeoff of Jurassic Park. And the last four seasons have been, clean seasons, have been, good, just a good show, I thought, overall. And they had the fifth season come out, and then they had to have a big lesbian love affair in it. And this show is directed towards kids, even though I'm an adult, I still like it, but it's directed for kids. And it was terrible, and they had this whole focus on this lesbian relationship between two young people, and everybody was cheering it on and everything. We are surrounded, we are where Satan's thrones is in most part of America today. So what do we need to do? We need to pray for protection from the ungodly. We need to realize that there are those who hate us and want to do us harm. There are those who desire to destroy the Lord's church. Psalms 43 verse 1 says, "Vindicate me, O God, and plead my cause against an ungodly nation. Oh, deliver me from this deceitful and unjust man." So we have to realize that we sit right now, if we look at it, in the midst of an ungodly nation. In many places, I can't say for every place in America, but many places, we're surrounded by ungodliness. We're surrounded by the teachings of the denominations and pagan religions. We are surrounded by people that are doing drugs and alcohol and having all kinds of sexual relationships, and people who are greedy and who steal and kill and murder and burn and tear. And remember a couple of summers ago when people were getting upset and they were going around and terrorizing cities and burning them down and hurting and killing people? And it seemed like the people that got in more trouble were the ones that defended themselves rather than the ones that was doing these terrible ungodly things. So we too sit where Satan's throne is. And we need to be careful of these people that they don't affect the church. They don't change the gospel because that's what they want to do. They want us to say that God approves of these ungodly things, these immoral things. And we can't do that. We can't go along with those who are controlled by Satan, those who want to do Satan's work, even if it means that they do hurt us in the end, even if it means that they harm us. Psalms 9, verse 17. Psalms 9, verse 17 says, "The wicked shall be turned into hell, and all the nations that forget God." Nations that forget God, and listen, our nation as a whole is forgetting God. I grew up in a nation that honored God, at least to a degree, and the generation before me honored God even more. You know, my mother had little sticker prizes for memorizing Bible verses in public school. And she showed me a Bible that she had, I think I might still have it even, that she got when she went to public school, and they would put little stickers in there when she memorized Bible verses. And of course, as time has gone on, they've tried to kick God and the Bible out of school all they could, and that certainly didn't help our nation any, did it? And as time has went on, more and more churches, even some of the Lord's churches, have collapsed, and their values collapsed in what the Bible says and has gone along with what the world says. And the more our nation and the more our churches, because listen, I believe that God's wrath is being held back on America because there are still good, godly men and women in this country. We know that God did that for Sodom and Gomorrah, right? He held back. It was 10 people in Sodom. 10 people, he would have held his wrath back for those 10 people. And I believe God is still holding his wrath back, at least his full wrath, because there are still godly people. But as we become less and less godly and more evil, and boy, I tell you what, we've really seen the evil of this nation, haven't we, when they've tried to try and make it where less babies are murdered recently. And people are out there fighting against it, screaming against it. Tell me that isn't where Satan dwells. Tell me that isn't where Satan dwells. Can you get more satanic than murdering a baby? Can you get more satanic than murdering a baby? Satan dwells here, and we need to be strong. We need to realize that this, if we're not careful, it's going to affect our families. It's going to affect our churches. And we must resist. We must resist, even if it means we are killed for it, even if it means we have to become a martyr. Hopefully that won't happen. But you know, God's church in the past, it has grown the fastest when it was persecuted in that way. So that's a motivation for me, because I don't want to have to go through that terrible persecution. So we need to get busy in trying to make new Christians, trying to bring the word of God to the world, even right into the heart of where Satan's throne is. Luke 9, verse 26. Luke 9, verse 26. "For whoever is ashamed of me and my words, of him the Son of Man will be ashamed when he comes in his own glory and in his Father's and of the holy angels." So we're not to be ashamed of God, we're not to be ashamed of Jesus, we're not to be ashamed of his words. So one of the things this church was doing, one of the good things this Church of Pergamos was doing, was they held fast to the name, and they did not deny the faith, even when they were being killed, even when there were people that were being killed for the faith. They hung strong. Remember, it reminds me here in America, quite a few years ago now, I guess it's been, but where those idiot gunmen went into the school and they asked kids if they were, you know, a Christian, and one or two of the girls said that yes, they were Christians, and of course they were murdered for that. terrible thing. But those girls did what was right. We are not to deny the Lord. We're not to deny His word, no matter what. No matter what. And we got to remember that we're not to deny Him and we're not to deny His word. Because we can't really separate those two, can we? And so many want to do that today. They want to water down Jesus and they want to water down Bible, where it's all love and mercy and grace, and everything else is kicked out. And listen, we all should be so thankful for the love and mercy and grace of God. It is so absolutely wonderful and important, and we can talk on that endlessly, but we also need to talk about judgment and how God hates sin and the other things that are also in the Bible. We're not to deny, because to deny the word of God is to deny Jesus. Is to deny Jesus. So we must stand up for Jesus and for His name, and we must stand up for His word and everything that is in the Bible. Everything. Everything. Listen, some things are a whole lot easier to stand up for than others, and especially in the particular culture that we live in today. But we can't cower away. We've got to be strong. We've got to hold to the truth. With so many churches out there, even in the Lord's churches, not holding to the truth, or not teaching the truth, or watering down subjects, or just not talking about it. You know, that's so easy to do. There's so many topics that if I had my rathers, I'd rather just not talk about it. Sometimes I've gone in to preach a sermon and I knew it was going to step on people's toes, and it's hard. I don't like doing that. You know, every once in a while I'll get up and I'll say, you know, this is a difficult sermon to preach. And I had somebody ask me just a few weeks ago in church here, why do you say it's difficult? Why do you say it's a difficult subject? And I told him, I go, because I know when I talk about this subject, there are people in this congregation that are dealing with this, either themselves or their loved ones, their children. I know they're dealing with this. I know this is a tough subject because the world is teaching the exact opposite of this. And we like just to forget that God says anything about it. And there's been so many times I wanted to just avoid subjects because I knew that there were going to be people that just didn't like that subject, and then they just wouldn't like me because of it. But I can't do that. Not if I'm going to save my own soul. Not if I'm going to save my own soul, because I will have to give account as a preacher, the gospel of Jesus Christ, and you're going to have to give an account. Whether you're a preacher, an elder, a deacon, a member, teacher, whoever you are, you're going to have to give an account. And our job, our mission, our goal, and our purpose as a Christian is to never deny the Lord, never to deny His word, and teach the whole word to Him. I've had people get on to me before and say, you know, why do you touch that subject? Let's make them a Christian first, and then you can go into that. And I'm like, oh, great, so I'm going to fool the person. You know, the person likes to go home and get drunk every night, and I'm not going to mention the sin of alcohol until after he becomes a Christian. That's not the way it works. It's not the way it works. We got to teach what the Bible says, and part of becoming a Christian is repentance, and there isn't... there isn't a list of things you don't have to repent of. Well, he really likes his booze, so, you know, we just won't mention that, or we won't tell him that he needs to repent of that. But, you know, over here we have our own pet sins that we want him to repent of. No, God, we've got to repent of everything, be willing to repent, willing to turn. Now, I realize it is a struggle of people, and people deal with cussing. Cussing is one. Boy, I tell you what, it's when you get those cuss words in your vocabulary and they're deep, it's hard to get them out. It's hard to stop cussing. can't always do it overnight, but you need to try, you need to work at it. So this church was doing right in the fact they wouldn't deny the Lord. They would not deny the Lord, even if it meant great suffering. Matthew 5, verse 10. Matthew 5, verse 10. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. We must be willing to suffer or to even die for the cause of Christ. You know, here we can whine about things that we may suffer being a Christian. Oh, they didn't invite me along, or they don't want me around, or if I would have gone out and had drinks with the boss, maybe I would have got that raise. Listen, I'm not denying those things aren't tough to a degree, but at least they're not murdering us, at least not wholesale yet. At least they're allowing us to work. But we've got to be ready to be willing to suffer persecution. And says here in the passage, for righteousness' sake. Listen, we're not talking about being persecuted because you did something stupid or some worldly issue, but being persecuted because you are a Christian, because you are different, because you're going to teach the Word of God. You are going to bring condemnation upon these people, not because you're doing it, but because the way that you live and the Word of God that you're going to bring is going to condemn their lives. And are they going to change that? Are they going to convert to be a Christian? Well, some might, but most are just going to hate you for it. Most are just going to hate you for it. So this church was doing right in that it stuck by the name of the Lord, and that it would not compromise on that, even if they persecuted them, even if it brought death to them. But the text says, I have a few things against you. One of the things was is because of those who hold the doctrine of Balaam. They were accepting those who held to the doctrine of Balaam. Romans 16:17. Now I urge you, brethren, note those who cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which you learnt, and avoid them. So they were to be looking out for people who were teaching things as a contrary to the doctrine. What is doctrine? It's teaching. Which teaching? The teaching of the Bible. So it wasn't telling you here to not to avoid somebody just because you don't like them. Listen, we're humans, and I want to be real here. Sometimes we can have people in the church that we don't get along well with, that bug us, that are difficult for us to deal with. That's not what it's talking about here. God says you got to deal with that stuff. You got to love your brother anyway. Find a way to work around it. But it's talking here about somebody that's bringing in false teaching, false preaching. It's contrary to the doctrine which we learn. And the doctrine which we learn, it needs to be the Bible. And anybody that brings anything in that is different than that, we are to avoid them. We're not to put up with it, not for one second. Listen, we need to put up with people sometimes as they work through sin. Sometimes as they work through sin, maybe they're a new Christian, as I said, and they're working through, watching the cuss words and things like that. We need to understand that's going to take time. They're going to have to work through that. Even mature Christian can get caught in sin, and we need to be patient with them. We need to work through that. Maybe somebody's been hurt by the church, and we need to work with them through that. But the one thing that we don't work through, so to speak, that we don't put up with, is false teaching. That just needs to end. Oh, yes, I understand we need to teach them. You know, we just don't, oh, you're a false teacher, you're out of the church because you said one thing wrong. No, we got to work with people and work through them with it, but we can't put up with it. We can't put up with it. It perverts the church of God. And pretty soon it's no longer the church of God, but it's a church of Satan. So we don't accept false teaching. You know, this thing here, the doctrine of Balaam, that could, today's day could be the doctrine of the Baptists, the doctrine of the Catholics, the doctrine of the Presbyterians, the doctrine of the Pentecostals, the doctrine of the Seventh-day Adventists, the doctrine of the Mormons, the doctrine of the Jehovah's Witnesses. Isn't it funny? And they all have different doctrines. They all have different doctrines. They all have some doctrines that are okay, that are aligned with the Bible. Every one of those groups does. Even the more cultish ones have some truth in them. But all of them for sure have things they teach that are false. And we don't let that doctrine into the church. Not for a minute. Not for a minute. Too many churches of Christ, they want to look out to this, to what they see as the successful Baptist church down the street, the successful Catholic church, the successful whatever. And they lust after that. Just like the Jews did in the Old Testament. They looked out upon the nations and they desired to be like them. And we look out upon the denominations and desire to be like them. If we were not careful, we're starting to let their doctrines in and their teachings in. And I'm not saying there aren't things in those groups that might not be beneficial, that might not be helpful to one degree or another, but we got to be sure they're scriptural. We got to be sure they're scriptural. And if they're not, we don't let them into the doors of the church. I'm not talking about the building. I'm talking about the house of God, the people of God. The people are the church, not the building. And we are a holy nation. We don't let this filth into our nation. But unfortunately, the church here was compromising, and they were letting these false doctrines in, these evil doctrines, even though they were still standing up for the name of Christ. In His Word, they were adding things, they were changing things to His Word, taking away from His Word. They were compromising, they were compromised. Why do we compromise? Why do we compromise? There's many reasons. Sometimes we're scared. Sometimes we're scared to not compromise. Sometimes it's just because we like what they're doing. We like to compromise. Sometimes we think that if we give a little, we'll get a little. You know, if we add the instrument, we're going to get people. You know what happens to most churches of Christ? When they add the instrument, they lose people. They lose people. Those who know the truth of God's will, they're gone. They're gone, and a lot of times those are the ones with the money. So they get their little band, they get their little hoedown or whatever it is they want, get somebody plunking on the piano or plunking on the harp or whatever they do. And most of the time they're not doing it very good. Listen, the denominations have been doing it for a long time now. You think we're going to be to their level the first time we bring a guitar in? No, it's going to sound pretty bad. And even in the denominations, most of the time I've heard these churches and they sound pretty bad. And if people are coming to church because they want to be entertained, well, you better be entertaining them, then you're not going to keep them. And you better get better, and you better do more, and you better start putting in more money and get that big drum set and get those big speakers that you can blast the rock singer or whoever you get. No, this is compromise. You're compromising. And if you get people who just want to be entertained, you're not getting Christians. Worship is not about entertainment for us humans. It is about entertaining God in heaven by giving Him our best and giving Him what He asked of us. Giving what He asked. He didn't ask for somebody to bang on a drum or bang on a guitar. He asked for us to sing. To sing. Worship is something that we're all to participate in. You don't give everybody a kazoo and let them go at it? We are to do things the way God tells us to do them, and to do anything different, to let the doctrine of Balaam in, is going to lead to death. It's going to lead to spiritual death. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 18. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 18. Flee sexual immorality. What does that mean? Flee, to run in the other direction, to not get close to it, to not get trapped by it, to flee. Every sin that a man does is outside the body, but he who commits sexual immorality sins against his own body. The body itself is the instrument of sin. And you're sinning against the body. Listen, sexual sins, God says, are different from other sins, and not different in a good way. But we see here that these people were even going to the point of committing sexual immorality. And we don't know what kind of sexual immorality that they were participating in. It doesn't matter. It's all wrong. And you got to remember, being here in Satan's throne, where Satan's throne was, they were probably surrounded by a lot of paganism. A lot of paganism. And you study paganism, you study the pagan gods, and almost all of them had to do with sexual things, nasty sexual things. And they were surrounded by this, and it was putting pressure on them, and they were giving in to it to some degree. And listen, it can be hard, can it? Because you look out in the world, and I remember being a teenager, it affected me. It seemed like everybody was having sex and it was being promoted. The songs on the radio was all about it, the television shows, the movies, the books, and just society in general was making sex look okay. And I tell you what, an awful lot of Christians compromise when it comes to this. An awful lot, and we see here the church itself. Because what happens a lot of times, this church can be strong in preaching and teaching against it, but there's still members out there participating in it, right? And that's wrong. But here we see that the church itself is being affected. It's being affected. And we see this today that's still going on in certain religious groups, don't we? We see some of the Mormons having their compounds where, you know, one man's married to a dozen or so women, and we celebrate this sexual immorality today. We have television shows about somebody having multiple wives. We see television shows about cross-dressing and homosexuality and lesbians, and you can go on and on and on. And this church was allowing sexual immorality even into the church. And I don't know for sure here, and it doesn't matter even, because we just know all sexual immorality is wrong, but I have a sneaky suspicion here that the law of it had to do there again being surrounded by the pagan culture that they were, and some from this church probably coming from paganism, and they were used to this kind of thing going on, shrine prostitutes, all that kind of thing, and it was probably there again creeping into the church. We have to be sure that we, as God's people, stay strong in sexual immorality, no matter what the world is saying, no matter how hard it pushes against us. And I'm telling you, folks, watch your children. If I have children today, first thing I do is I pull them out of public school. And I know some parents that would say, well, if we pull our kids out, they can be an influence. It could be an influence. We want them to be an influence on the other kids. Listen, do you know how hard it is for us to be an influence when everybody's against us? And you're going to think your kid can handle that? Grow up! No, you need to keep your kid away from that. Teach them to be strong so that they can deal with it, so they can live a life that isn't affected by the perversion, so they can go out there and teach what's right and what's wrong, no matter the opposition. But you're saying you're 7, 8, 10-year-old in there to do that? Shame on you. Shame on you. Listen, I was a youth minister for a long time, and I worked with kids for a long time. And things are a lot worse now, because now you have the teachers teaching it. Oh, they just ain't learning this stuff from the kids anymore. You have the teachers in these public schools teaching this stuff. Sending them to hell is what they're doing. Watch your kids, because just as I said earlier about that animation that was made for kids, that was clean up to a point, and then all of a sudden it took that big switch, it took that big turn. Watch what your kids watch. Watch who they're with. Watch who their teacher is. Watch what they're being taught. They're your kids. Raise them right. These people are also holding to the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which God hates. We've seen this already in the first church that we looked at, didn't we? God hates the teaching of the Nicolaitans. He hates it. And if God says he hates something, I think we better pay attention to that. And I think we better hate it also. There again, as I said in that video, we don't quite know who the Nicolaitans were. There's people out there have taken some educated guesses. We're not sure what they were teaching. There were some educated guesses of that. But what we do know for sure, and if the Bible wanted us to know more, it would have told us more. What we do know for sure is they weren't teaching what the Bible said, and God hates that. Oh, but it's just a little bit off. Oh, but it's just a little compromise. No, God hates that. We are not to compromise. Jude 4. For certain men have crept in unnoticed, who long ago were marked out for this condemnation, ungodly men who turn the grace of our God into lewdness and deny the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. So here again, we see these people were denying God, and to deny God is to deny his teachings. And they weren't following what God wanted them to do. And they were in big trouble for this. Listen, be a watchman on the wall for false teaching. Be a watchman on the wall for false teaching. Don't let any of it in. Don't compromise one inch. The devil is never happy of compromise. He ain't going to accept that. Oh, he's fine with it if that's all he can get at the moment, but all it does is open the door, weakens your position, so he can kick the door down and move in that much quicker. We must stand. We must stand strong. And we must be careful, because over and over again throughout these churches in Revelation, God is teaching us about how wrong this false doctrine, false teachers, false prophets, and false churches are, and how they will destroy your soul. They will take your candlestick away, and they will send you to hell. And we don't want that. We don't want them to go there, so we want them to change and do what we can that way. But if they won't do it, we need to protect ourselves, and we need to protect the Lord's church. The Lord told this church to repent of these things. He says, repent or I'll come quickly and will fight against you with the sword of my mouth. What's the sword? What does the sword represent? Well, the sword today would be more representative of a gun, because it represented power, it represented death, it represented slaughter, it represented all these things, authority, represents all these things. Just as a gun does so today. So he's saying, I will fight against you. You want God to fight against you? You do these things. You let Balaam in. You let the Nicolaitans in. You let these false teachers. You let some sexual immorality into your church. God will fight against you. And let me tell you something. God's gonna win. God's gonna win. Like the Johnny Cash song says, one of the last songs that Johnny Cash did has a line there to the effect of God's going to cut you down. God's going to cut you down if you do these things. So God wants you to be scared. He wants you to be concerned about this. And he wants you to repent. And I dare say, is there any church out there that doesn't need to repent for something that it's doing, for something that it has done. Acts 3 verse 19 says, "Repent therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, so the times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord." So he's telling them to repent. What is repent? It's to turn away. It's to turn to. It's to turn from. Turn to what's right. Turn away from what's wrong. It says, be converted. Be converted. Some of us need to be converted again, don't we? We need to be converted again. Maybe we were converted at one time, but we've got off track. We've let worldliness and ungodliness and false doctrine and false teaching to affect our minds and our thoughts and our actions and our deeds. And we need to be converted so that our sins may be blotted out. Oh, don't you love our sins are blotted out? They're just not a line drawn through them. Or God doesn't say, well, I'm going to keep these sins over here just in case I need to go back and look at them again. And no, so they can be blotted out. They're gone. They're gone. So the times of refreshing may come. So we can be renewed. We can be God's children once again. We can be holy and blameless before God. And we should all desire that. We should all want that. And we should all strive for that. The text also says, to him who overcomes, we're going to see this throughout the seven churches, to him who overcomes, what will he who overcome get? And in all these churches, it tells you a little something different, but ultimately, it's heaven, it's Jesus, it's salvation, it's sanctification. John 14, verse 2, and don't you just love this? In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. For you, isn't that wonderful to think about? That in heaven, if you hang on, if you do what's right, if you turn back, if you need to, if you repent, if you need to, and who of us doesn't need to repent for something? He has a place for you. A place for you. When I was a real estate agent, I got to see a lot of nice places, a lot of big places, a lot of places that I could only dream about. I used to like to do that. I used to like to go when I wasn't working even. I had the key to the lockbox, and I'd go to these places. And part of it was my job, because I needed to see what these places looked like so I could tell other people. But part of it was I just enjoyed seeing these wonderful big houses. But the problem with these wonderful big houses is that even if you get one, they break down, don't they? And sometimes they can become more of a nuisance than a blessing. And you got to pay the payment every month and on and on and on. But they were still neat to go into and just to look at them and dream a little bit. But you know what's even neater is to be able to dream about the house that God is building for us. A house that you're not going to have to make payments on, a house that will never, never be torn down or grow old or the plumbing. Listen, we have a church building here, and I have an office, and we have where the minister lives. They're all old buildings. The one here right now, I was built around the end of World War II. My office was about 1919. It's been remodeled, of course, but it's still an old house. And I think the one that the preacher's house was probably in the late 70s, early 80s. And there's always something going wrong. There's always something breaking. And it's a pain. But someday that will be gone. Someday that will be over. And we'll have this house that's built by God that will last forever and ever and ever. And there'll be no repairs. There'll be no problems with it. What a wonderful thing to think about. What a great dream to have. And the Lord wants that for everyone. It's there for everyone. And it's free, but it's conditional. It's absolutely free. It's absolutely free. Oh, I've heard that before in life. Oh, it's free, and it wasn't free. But this is absolutely free, but there are conditions, because even to free things, there are conditions. In order to get that wonderful house, in order to be with the Lord forever, in order to be one of his spiritual children, you have to hear the word of God. That's what I've tried to bring to you today. And then you got to believe. You got to have faith. You got to believe everything in the Bible is true and be willing to follow it. And you got to repent of your sins, to turn from your sins, to turn away, turn to God. You got to confess Jesus is the Son of God, make the good confession. Then you have to be baptized. You're baptized to wash away your sins. And when that happens, the Lord, not man, because man can't do this, but the Lord puts you into his church, into his kingdom. And then you must remain faithful unto death. And if you do that, if you do those things, you receive that reward. You receive that mansion, that glorious place in heaven, prepared just for you. If you are watching this today because maybe you're shut in or for some reason you haven't been able to make it to your regular service, please don't forget the other acts of worship. Please don't forget to sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs to the Lord, to pray to the Lord, to take the Lord's Supper, and to give to the Lord's church an offering of your means. I want to thank you for watching this. If you found it useful and helpful, please share it with others. I hope that you have a wonderful, wonderful week, and God bless you.